This edition of Computer Club Lesson was recorded on November the 7th, 2016. In this edition, we're going to tell you everything you need to know about Skype. Hello, welcome to Computer Club Lesson. This episode is brought to you by the Binary Guys. Okay, well, it's 1 o'clock, folk, and it's time to start. So, James,
1 o'clock.
It's almost 1 o'clock. Time to start. And so, James wants to make a little presentation here before we start, and then we'll get to the program for today. So, James, go ahead.
So, you know those lock screens that keep happening and have a picture? You can change those pictures to whatever you'd like, as well as your desktop.
The other word for it would be login screen. Lock screen and login screen they're the same thing.
My apologies.
No, that's not a screensaver. What you see on the screen that's not a screensaver either. That's just
the desktop.
A desktop. A screensaver is something that comes on when the computer goes to sleep. But it's also
to keep you entertained.
In Windows 10, it can also be the lock screen. Okay? So there's 100 ways to look at it, but we're talking about the lock screen.
Is this the one that says, do you like this?
Yeah. They're nice. You get lots of them.
So you can change those to any pictures you like. If you go to the start menu and go to this tiny gear above the upside down Q, the power options, and click the settings and personalization, this is where you can change every picture that you would see. So underneath lock screen, that's the only reason why I'm calling it lock screen is because the settings call it that. You can change it to, it will always be on Windows Spotlight, so it will always show you, hey, this is the one we think you'd like and stuff. You can do slideshow if you want multiple pictures. But if you do picture, you can then browse for that picture. And I'm just going to pick one on the desktop. We'll do this one. So now, when you start up the screen, it will be that picture and that picture alone, if you do picture. So you can change it to anything, even if you like one of the previous ones that were shown. For example, if you like that lake view for the mountain, or looking at a beach underneath a cave. To change your actual background, you would just do the background option, and same thing, put it to picture and make it what you'd like. We'll do this one. So now, this picture was taken a long time ago. But now that can be your desktop picture and things. Or you can make your theme, your lock screen the same.
Anything your little heart desires. Yeah. Pictures of your grandchildren, your significant other. Whatever picture you have on your computer, you can go and find it and put it there.
Yeah. Now you do have to go find it, so you need to know where it is. But other than that, you can change it to whatever you like. Excuse me.
Yeah. Question then.
Yeah.
If I've got the screen up, how do I get to pictures without getting rid of the screen? Go to my pictures, find the one I want. How do I get it from my pictures to the...
What you're looking at here, Brenda, is if you're not sure where it is, go to my pictures and find it first.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then when you go through this procedure of finding the picture you want, you can navigate to it like you did before.
Yeah, I'll just do a quick example. So once you hit browse, you'll come up with this window. It's just like any file explorer or looking, opening up a document or anything. So I know it's in my pictures are in pictures. Yeah. So I would scroll down to desktop, or actually, where is it? Oh, there it is, pictures. And I could get it that way. Or if I really wanted to get complicated, I could go through this PC and then do pictures. But so I want this one to be our, well, also this was, hold on. So then once you find it, you can hit yes, I want this as my picture. And
now that right now you're going to undo that right away. I'm going to tell you what, because what you see on the screen right now is a screenshot of the computer. It's a picture.
I was going to show
the computer.
As,
right?
See, we have 2 Ace shampoos now, 2 Libra offices.
So James is going to undo that right now. That's where you can get into trouble. Okay? If you don't realize what you've done.
Yeah, I knew what I was doing.
Yeah, you knew what you were doing, and you were going to leave it like that for me. Work. The technical term for that, James, is you're a toad.
Okay, we're okay now.
You've undone that.
Yes, I swear. Okay, so Grandpa's going to talk about the actual program now. While I just gently walk over here.
You can walk over there. Go back to your hovel back there.
You call my room.
Back to your hovel. Okay, James and I are going to do a demonstration with Skype a little later on, but what we want to do right now is I want to talk about a program that we're going to use to show you what we're doing. Now, the two of us today are going to be taking over this screen. Okay? We're going to be taking it over. James is going to have a picture of his computer on this screen, and I'm going to have a picture of my computer on this screen at the same time. And so what we're going to be doing here is using a program called TeamViewer. Now, some of you already have it. I've put it on your computer so that I can manipulate your computer from my house. Okay, if you call me and it's some little problem, I can just ask to log into your computer from my office and fix your little problem. Okay, that's how I do it with this program called TeamViewer.
If I don't have it, can I download it?
Yes, you can download it from teamviewer.com. Okay. Now, the download and installation is pretty simple. I'm going to show you the website for TeamViewer. And okay, it's going to take us to teamviewer.com here in a second. Here it comes. Okay. Now, it wants you to buy, and it's supposed to be free.
No.
Am I in the wrong spot?
No. Well, yes, but no. You can go to the download section.
Yep.
Right there. And download TeamViewer. It's mainly wanting you to buy the
Not commercial.
The full-on production commercial type. This is for home use. And so you can download for Windows, Mac, Linux, and all kinds okay, download TeamViewer. You'll find the green button. And when you download it, you can install it right away. It will not install itself. You have to make it install. But the installation is, the last time I did it, which was about 3 weeks ago, is as easy as pie. You follow the default instructions that it gives you. Read them slowly and carefully. But the biggest thing is you want to use it for personal use. If you tell it, well, I want to buy the commercial one, well, it's going to stop right there and demand money. But if you buy it for commercial or for personal use, it is the full-on TeamViewer. It's just that there may be some background restrictions of things you can't do that a professional IT guy would do. But for our purposes, no. There are no restrictions on it for what we would need to do. And so there's a TeamViewer for you. Now, I am going to, just to show you, I'm going to bring up James's desktop here. Come on. There. There's James's. That's what's appearing on James's computer right now.
Well, I think it crashed a bit because I closed that. There it goes.
Yeah. So he can open up this PC, James, and you'll see that it's.
Mind you, it's going to be like a
delay. Yeah. So there's a little bit of a delay, but we can live with that. That's just simply because there's a lot going on back and forth over the internet. There's a lot of instructions going back and forth to make this work. So there is a little bit of a delay. But I can now take over James's computer, so I can close this and I can open something else. I can open his Firefox. Okay, and so it's going to open here in a second. There you go. His Firefox is opening on his computer, but I can see it. I can manipulate it. I can make entries. When I open files and folders, I can change stuff on his computer. Likewise, if he could see mine by asking to log into my computer, he can do stuff. But that's not what we're going to let happen today, folks.
Mm-hmm. So why would, apart from you, I can understand you going on that so you can help people when they're having problems. But what reason would I have to be viewing somebody else's?
You wouldn't. This is only for me and you and making your life a little easier, my life a little easier. If you've got a small problem, or you explain your problem to me and I say, oh, that's a small problem. I don't have to come to your house. I can fix this in 5 minutes. Just open your computer up, fire up TeamViewer, and I will make the fix.
So it's not like FaceTime or anything?
No, it's not. So now what we're going to do is we're going to, that's pretty much the explanation of TeamViewer and the program that we're going to use today. It's a very useful program. So if you, as a matter of fact, I think we did a video on TeamViewer maybe a year ago. I showed you how to download it and install it. It's the same today as it was then, if you go looking for it.
Can you tell me if there's updates to it?
Yes. Now, here's the thing. Right now, I'm using TeamViewer 11 on these two computers. The update now is TeamViewer 12.
Okay.
TeamViewer 11 may stop working on TeamViewer 12, and I will have to update. But that means everybody else in my circle has to update to 12 from 11.
Yeah.
So we have to be careful about making updates, but that's something that I would talk to you about as you downloaded it.
Okay.
And I have a way of going back to TeamViewer 11 for all my other customers, but if you have 12, well, yeah. Okay, so for now, we are going to get out of this, and James is going to come and talk to you about Skype, and then we will do a live demonstration of how Skype is supposed to work. Okay, so James, come on up.
Well, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
If I download TeamViewer, then will it be 11 or 12?
It'll be 12.
It'll be 11.
Oh. No, it'll be 12 beta.
I just downloaded it yesterday.
Well, okay.
I got 11.
All right. Well, it's saying beta 12.
It's that saying buy the update.
All right. Whatever.
So,
okay.
It might be 11.
I'm not buying.
All right, if that's what you did, I did mine a month ago, so whatever.
Yesterday.
Okay, there's Skype. So, James, hey, Bob, tag, you're up.
Once you've gone, gone off, you're not using my site anymore, okay?
Yeah.
Do you still have a...
I should mention about that.
Yeah.
The thing about TeamViewer is that initially when you open it, you get this panel. It's going to give you a 9-digit number that is your number for as long as you own this computer. If you ever have to redo TeamViewer completely, it's going to give you a new number. But this 9-digit number is special to you, okay? I will ask you for that 9-digit number and you'll give it to me. And then I will say, connect to partner. All right, I'll click on that. And another little dialog box will come up and it will ask for a password. Now on mine, this is mine here, 522-2463. My password is a 4-digit number, 7641. That's good for one session.
One
session. If we close TeamViewer and start all over again, that password will be different. So even if somebody knows your 9-digit ID number, okay, they've got 10,000 guesses to get logged in. Because it's just a guess. They don't know. It changes every single time.
Oh, so when we open it, we get to see the password. And
yes, and you give it to me. Okay. Exactly so.
Gone when we're done.
Exactly.
Right, okay.
So that's what makes the security of it, is that, yes, even if somebody knows that 9-digit ID number, they still can't get in because they've got to guess 4-digit, in other words, 10,000 numbers, 1 to 10,000. That number could be 0001. It could be 49. Okay? All right. There, that does that, James. Now you are up, unless there's no other questions. James, you're up.
All right. So, the other thing I should just mention quickly about TeamViewer is, if you close the program, even if they knew your ID and password, because the program's not open, it wouldn't work. Because the programs have to be both open to one another. Oops, no, I don't want to close that. Oops. There we go. So, I'm going to talk about Skype. We talked a little bit about the settings of how to change the settings so you can hear yourself and so you can talk into a mic. But essentially, when you first start up, you'll be on this screen, and where it will say anyone who's updated their profile in Skype and you'll have all your contacts over here. You can even change that so it can be the most recent ones you've talked to for a certain amount of time. So, with Skype, there are two ways to add people onto Skype. If you have a Facebook account, you can put in your Facebook account, and let me just see, I think that's you. Here. I don't know where they put it now. They changed it. I think that it's when you first start up, probably. Oh well. In any case, the best way to find people on Skype is searching for their handle. Which his is Bob-BinaryGuy. If you search for their names, like I will search for my name, and on a most basic part, you'll get all this. This is every person that will have James as their name. So, unless you know what you're looking for, it's best to use the handles instead of their names, because you can only have one handle, which is essentially a nickname, like an email address.
And it's unique to you.
Yeah.
So searching for a handle, let us just say that you have a relative in a faraway land and you want to talk to them on Skype. You need to contact them first, either by email or telephone or whatever, and ask them for their Skype handle. And once you have that, you can then find them on Skype. Whether they're logged into Skype or not, you can find them by their handle.
Yeah. So, another good example is my dad. So if I search him, there are like 20,000 different Chris TCs in here. And it would be just a pain to go through here.
Computer.
Oh, it's my computer?
It might be my phone.
You know what? It might be my phone. Oh well. If it's work, I just. So, going through all these Chris TCs to find the right one, unless I knew what his profile picture is and where he lives and whatnot, it would be a nightmare. But if I did his handle, it would be a lot easier. Now, I don't remember his handle off the top of my hand. But I know it's this one right here. So, with searching, you can find your friends, add them. And we're going to show you how to add and how to call them later.
Do you just sign up for it?
Yeah, it's free. You make an account. By when you first install it, we'll say make a Skype account or use an existing one. And if you don't already have a Skype account, you just make one, put in your name. You can put in a profile picture if you like. Stop texting me. and just fill out all the information. You'll hit OK. You will need an email address as well.
Is that where you choose a handle?
Yeah. Okay. It will say your handle will essentially be your login, and then you pick a password and all that.
A good way to do it is to use your email name, because usually your email name is unique to you.
Yeah.
And in your case, it would be. Okay. If you use Outlook, your email name is going to be unique, so you can use that as a handle. Or you can choose your name and put a number behind it, and then it becomes unique.
Yeah. It will tell you if it's not unique. It will say, that's already taken. Please pick another password or handle. And
is there a difference between the app and downloading it from
No, if you have, if you signed into the app or anything, if you signed in with both, with the same account, yeah.
Okay, but it's an app.
Yeah, it's the same. As long as you sign in with the same login with anything, they'll automatically update and say, these are your contacts. You don't have to re-add them anytime you go.
Excuse me, Jim.
Yeah.
I'm a little confused. I don't have Skype.
Yeah.
Is this something you turn your computer on like your first screen? What do you do from there? Type in Skype or...
Yeah, for this computer, because we already had it installed, I had to search it with Cortana to find it, and just type in Skype. It would be right there. If you don't have Skype installed, you'll know if it doesn't show up here. You will have to go to Google or something and just type in Skype. And the very second one, not the ad one. You just go in there, and you can get Skype for anything, really. You just get Skype for Windows, mobile, tablet, Xbox, wearables, and TV.
And this is face-to-face talk.
You can do face-to-face. We'll do that
okay.
later, but there is video call, just normal call, and what is the short form for it? SMS?
Yeah.
Real
time. There's texting.
Yeah.
SMS.
Short message service.
Yeah. So you can just do text or voice or video, which also has voice. So once you do that, it's pretty simple. Just follow the instructions. And it will, most of the time, unless you unchecked it, it will put Skype on your desktop. So once you have that and made your account, the first thing you need to do is go to Tools and Options. Now in here you need to go to Audio Settings and make sure that one, your microphone works and the computer can actually hear it, and make sure the speakers also work. So that's just the test for it, and you can adjust it accordingly. Now typically the speakers, everything will be automatically adjust microphone settings and speaker settings. I find it's better to uncheck for microphone and put it where the green typically goes, as any higher than that and you don't pick it up, and any lower than that you'll be too loud. So you need to fiddle with it. Grab a friend or family member at one point and just help them, get them to help you set up Skype to make sure it sounds good and whatnot. Or you can use the Echo sound test service where you speak into the mic and then it repeats what it said to you.
This is all free service.
Yeah, 100% free. I think the only part you need to pay for, which no one really uses, is if you have, let's say you search for a business, you can Skype them. Skype can act as a phone and will dial a phone number and can call someone through that.
But it's the business that pays for that, not you.
Yeah. But you have to pay for the service of being able to do that. So the other thing you would need to do in Tools and Options is go to video settings. This is just to make sure that your camera works. And you can even make it your profile picture by taking a picture of a thumbs up or whatnot. And you can change the settings in here. Typically, if you have a laptop, it will automatically make the microphone and speakers, as almost all all laptops have a microphone built in, as well as a camera. So it will already make that for you. If you're a desktop user, you will have to go in here, and on this down tab, you just have to click here and pick the microphone and the speakers you're using. So if you're using a headset, you need to know what the computer calls it and change it accordingly. So in the rest of the settings, there's not too much to change. I typically just keep them all where it needs to be. Yeah. So there's really nothing else that needs to be changed in here. So once you've got your mic and everything working, you can continue. There are some things that you can do. Typically when you have Skype, it will automatically open when you turn on your computer. I don't know if we should show them how to stop that from happening. Or do you think it's too much? Or
it's probably too much.
Okay.
If Skype becomes a real pain in the A, you can tell it not to launch when the computer starts. You've got to look around for that. But if you ever have trouble with it, just call us and let us know, and we will talk you through how to turn that off.
Well, he'll do that. but the other thing that that Skype likes to do is I lost the word. Oh well.
You're hanging around old folks.
I had this problem long before you guys.
Excuse me, Jim, what is that? Is that what you're searching for, a name for where it says take a fit test? Are those little add-ons where they sort of...
Yeah, that's an ad, because since Skype is a free program, they just do ads just so they can get paid and keep it for free. Typically, you don't have to worry about those. But yeah, to just find friends, you just go to the search option above your contacts and start typing, and you can typically find whoever. Now, Skype will always have you online, but if you are watching a movie and don't want to be disturbed, you can click on your profile picture and change whether you want to be away, do not disturb, just appear offline or invisible.
Is there a noise when somebody's trying to... I keep my thingamy turned off.
Yeah, there is a noise. Typically when someone Skypes you through text, you'll get pretty much a high-pitched beep or badoop.
Even when my speakers are turned off?
No, if your speakers are turned off, you won't hear them. Right. But it will still like try to make the noise.
Okay.
I could probably find that noise. Well, this is the sound that would play when trying to call you. Okay, where's the... things were here. This thing.
There somewhere.
I don't see it.
No, it's not what you...
No, I think it's this one?
Well, this is a mess. Don't plug it in, James, because when we do start to do the demonstration, that's going to be really loud.
Yeah.
We don't want that.
Sure. You can tell what they are, what sounds they are. It'll just sound like a ringing of some kind. But yeah, you can even have group calls in Skype, which is essentially if you want to talk to both, like, your daughters and your sons and some guy named Joe in the United States. You can talk to all of them, add them all to a call, and anything you type in that call as well will all go to them as well.
Is that like a conference call?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. You can pretty much do a conference call. I should say though, the more if you have more than one other person in Skype in a Skype call, you can't do video. Because one, it just takes too much bandwidth to do anything, and second, I think that's also premium as well. But yeah, you can just add people to the call, and once you do have someone on here, you just go to their name and hit call, video call, or type down here, and once you send it, it will go to them. You can also, with Skype, send documents to a certain degree. They have to be, we'll say, below 16 kilobytes. So like if you want to show them a picture, you can send them a picture through Skype. Typically you can just grab the picture and drag it in. Skype now has emoticons, as they're called, and you can send these things to your things as well. They also have what's called a emoji. I call them GIFs or GIFs, whatever one you prefer. And typically those are a video with a sound. It's a very short clip, and you can send them that as well, if you want to be silly. Or why not? Typically, that's all you need to do. If you want to edit anything in your profile, you just click your name. And here you can add a picture if you didn't already. Change your mood if you want. Put in your email. And make it if people can see your profile picture or not. You can also add, I think that is mood now that I think about it. You can add where you are, so they better, if someone's trying to find you, they can better find you. That still didn't make sense. And typically what the mood is just a short little message where it tells you, like my grandma's, for example, it says, is busy at the moment playing Farmville. like even I had one. This is mine because we made sure it worked. But like I was. Anyone knows the song "Cliffs of Dover" by Eric Johnson? Yeah.
The original.
So that song, pure guitar, pure everything, no vocals whatsoever. Me being me, I accidentally wanted to find it on YouTube, but I added with lyrics on that, and I'm like, wait, there's no lyrics to it. Why did I add lyrics? So I made my mood that stupid moment when you search for Eric Johnson, Cliffs of Dover with lyrics, and then remembering there are no words. So it's just something to keep you updated. Like, I used to update how difficult work was. But you can have some fun in the mood. I think that pretty much covers all the basics that you need to know. Everything else you don't really need to know. Now, for people, I just found this, for people who actually have Outlook, you can show Outlook contacts. I'm pretty sure that's just a sorting, though. So if people in your contacts list have Outlook, you can see who. That pretty much covers it. So I think we're going to do our...
We're going to do a demonstration
now
of how this works, and
how to add people, how to have a call,
and essentially what it's going to look like. The reason we're doing this is to see, is to make sure that you understand that this might be a good thing for you, because this is a communications tool. And if you have family and friends that are far away and they have computers, this is usually a simple thing for you both to do to communicate with one another in a more personal way than just email.
Yeah, the other thing is, sorry, I'm not on email, I'm trying to make sure the mic picks me up, is that talking long distances, you can talk to anyone in the world with it and don't have to pay a dime.
I was just going to ask, there's no distance limit?
Nope.
I talk to people from Australia, Japan, United States. We all just get in a call. The only problem with talking long distances is...
the lag.
Yeah, there will be a lot of lag if the farther you go away. But that's typically easy to deal with. It doesn't affect anything. But it'll just make the person talk like a Japanese movie.
Yeah.
The lips go, and then you hear the sound after.
Okay, James is going to start by launching his Skype. And what you're seeing on the screen now is James's computer through TeamViewer. And what you're seeing is what he sees on his desktop. And so the first thing that James is going to do is he's going to search for me. Now, because we did this before, and the computer has remembered who I am, okay? And so he's searched for my handle, Bob-BinaryGuy, and found me right away.
Now, if I do hit search to find other people, it won't, because no one else has his account. So
yeah. Binary Guy is unique to me. Okay? If somebody else wanted to use Bob-Binary Guy, they could use Bob-Binary Guy with a number. And they're different from me.
Yeah, and they will only search for what you typed.
Yeah.
So if you only type in binary, it won't look for Bob-Binary Guy. It'll look just for binary. So you need to make sure that you type everything out.
Yeah. And that's where contacting your friends and getting their Skype handle from them, either in email or over the phone or however you want to do it. That's the best way to search for somebody and get them. Now, at this point, James does not have to be friends with me. He can call me. Okay. He can call me just simply by bringing up my profile right here on his screen, and he can click on the call button over here, and he will call me. Yeah, go ahead, and we can get out of it right away. And he's going to call me, and I'm going to come back to my screen. And this is my screen, and James is calling me. Okay? I'm going to say no to this for right now. Because what we're going to do now is James is going to search my name, and he's going to ask me to be his friend. Okay, it's not really a friend; it's a contact. Okay, so at this point, I want you to send me a contact request.
Now, I should say it's going to be a bit different for you when you do it the first time, but we'll have a giant blue button that says contact or send friend request. Since I already did it, it's just in small text underneath the yellow, if you would point to it, Grandpa. Underneath the yellow, where it says busy. Now, underneath that, it will say resend contact request, and that's what I just have to do, because again, we tried this before. Now, as you do send the friend request, you can add a personal message. It will just typically say, hi, Bob Williams, I'd like to add you as a contact. You can say, hey, it's me, so-and-so, and let's be friends.
Did you send that?
No.
Okay, send it now. In a minute or so, or less than a minute, I should get a notification that James has sent a contact request to me. And it hasn't turned up yet. Up, there it is. Okay. So contacts, one recent. Okay. And if I click on that, there's James as a contact request. Okay. Now, in the testing, because we went through all the brouhaha originally, there was more to do, but in this case, there's not more to do, because James has...
No, you would have to click it.
Yeah. James has sent me the request. Now I have to accept it. Okay? So, from anyone that wants to talk, be a contact, you have to accept them. They don't just get to be a contact and bother you, okay? So you have to accept it. So in this case, I will accept it. And it's telling me that James is online and that I accepted his request. Okay, now, at this point, I can call James just simply by highlighting his name and going over to the call button. But I am going to call James with video. So I'm going. So I click on video call, the little camera. All right, now you're seeing James's screen. All right, you're seeing James's screen because he accepted my video call. Here is James down here. Okay, that's how we know. If we go over to my screen, okay, there's James, and I can add him as video call. Oops. Okay, he's frozen up for some reason or other.
It's because you keep going back and forth.
Yeah. But there's me down in the corner, and James is here. Ordinarily, it would not be frozen. Oh, there we go. He's starting to move. It's the internet's catching up with what we want to do here. So at this point, I want James to hang up. Hang up. Okay, so he's hung up. We're still looking at James's we're still looking at James's screen. So he's hung up the call for me. And by the way, it puts a list in here. of who has called, how long the call was for, and all of that. So you can keep track of it if you want to. You know, did somebody call me last week? It'll be in here as a list. And so I'm going to go back to me. There we go. Is that me? No, that's not me. That's me. That's oh. James. Oh, that's James.
You're on the right one. You're okay. Need some help, old man.
Why do I have you with two screens?
You don't.
You're still on James's screen, are you?
That's the right one. No, go back. Cancel that. Cancel. That's the right one. Because you're looking at my...
All right, I'm looking at your screen in the background. That's me. Okay. All right, that's my application. All right. I finally got it. Hallelujah. Well, we are looking at two computers on one screen, so it's getting a little confusing for us. Yeah. But what we have done here is we've shown you just... Basically, it is easy to set up, and if you do have a little bit of trouble with it, with your friends, get them on the phone and work through your problems over the phone while you're setting Skype up, because once you've done that, all your communications from there on is personal and for free.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
You say it's open all the time. I turn my computer on and it's there.
Yeah, it will launch all by itself.
What about when I just want the world to go away and I sit and play games? I don't want beeps and buzzers.
Okay.
I don't want anybody. Why aren't you on? My kids pick up the phone. Why did you answer us, Mommy? Dead yet?
All right. In that case, when you have launched Skype, or Skype has launched when your computer starts up, down here in the running applications, right here on the lower right, you will see a little green icon, and that is Skype. Okay, if you right click on that icon, you can tell it to quit. And by quitting, that closes Skype.
So they don't know I'm on the computer.
Yeah, they don't know. You're not on. They might see you as a contact in theirs,
yeah.
But you will show up on theirs as not online. Okay.
Now I should say the difference between doing quit and closing with the X is the X only essentially minimizes it. It will still beep and boop and.
And show that you're online.
Yeah.
It's just so it's not showing. It will be running in the background. Quitting is the only way to turn it off for good.
And how do I put it back on?
It just, Skype is on your desktop, just click it and launch it, launch it again.
I guess I take the little cover off my webcam then.
Yeah, I've got mine.
Well, yeah, that's... let's talk about that for just a moment. Your webcam will become active with Skype. For quite a while there have been hacks and stuff that can activate your webcam without your knowledge. Okay, if you have a little light beside. Your webcam on your computer, and that little light is supposed to light up like mine is not doing. Okay, to show you that the webcam is active, let me just go here to tools. It might light up. Options, video settings. Okay, yeah, mine did light up as soon as the video came on. So it is active, but with this hack. That light goes out, so you don't know that someone is looking at you. That's why it's recommended you put a little piece of tape over your camera when you're not using it. if that's if you are really worried about that kind of thing. Okay. Now, if you have your laptop in your bedroom, sitting on your makeup table or on your bed, when it's and it's open and it's on, and there are people out there who might be interested in that fact. Those are what Donald Trump refers to as pervs.
Yep, don't we all?
Yeah. So, yeah, do
I'm
you...
Weirdos,
yeah, but pervs and weirdos. But if that is a concern to you, yes, put a piece of tape over it.
I only put a piece of tape over it because you said do it a year ago.
Yeah. But if those things are not really a concern to you, your computer is in a place where you're not going to be wandering by with half draped in a towel. Okay, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it.
The exhibition is kind of fun,
right? Yes, yeah. And there are people who love to do that, turn their cameras on all day long. There are websites that you can sign up for and broadcast anything you want 24/7, and in some cases you can be paid handsomely for it. They do it another way, but you can be paid handsomely for that kind of thing. There are people.
Today's video is sponsored by Gopher.
So, that's pretty much what we've wanted to tell you about Skype today. Are there any questions or concerns about Skype? Yes.
Now, that needs your location, does it not?
No. Microsoft might sort of insist that you give your location, but it's not required. Okay.
The other day I was on Google, and Google asked.
Yeah, that's so that it can send you more advertising, and Skype is the same way. It's like we said, there's ads here, so if it knows your location, it can send you more personalized ads. So here's something for seats for your car. If it's personalized, more personalized, it may show you an advertising from Johnson Motors. Okay.
So it might be a good idea to click yes for that then?
You can, but then you might get more personalized advertising, but you might get a whole lot more of it too.
Is this provided by Microsoft?
Yes. Yeah. Microsoft owns Skype.
Yeah, Microsoft recently bought Skype. Typically, if you buy anything that is Microsoft, you already have it installed. Like Xbox will have it.
It comes with it.
Just click on the Skype icon, it's there.
Yeah.
Yes, it is. Yeah. Awesome. Do you have to, like you said, you have to open up a Skype account. Can you use your Microsoft account?
Yes. Yes, you can.
Yeah. Wonderful.
Because your Microsoft account is unique to you.
Yeah, because my cat is my picture.
Yeah.
My face.
Yeah. And so if you can log in, if you don't have a Skype login right now, you can log in with your Microsoft account, your email name and your password.
Yes.
From the Skype program.
Now, it might actually be better if you have a Microsoft account to do with the Microsoft account. Because, like I said, if you sign in with the same account, everything will be transferred over. So if you so happen to lose your computer, if you still sign in with your Microsoft account on Steam, or not Steam, Skype, all your contacts will show up, all your settings will be the same, and everything. So it's typically best to, if you know what you've done for one, make sure you remember that because it will always...
Is that like on a cloud? On the cloud?
Yeah.
Okay. It's all on the Microsoft cloud.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, here again, I'm going to show you one more time how to get out of Skype completely. The icon, the little green cloudy icon down at the bottom of the screen, lower right. You right click on it and you click on quit. It will prompt you, are you sure you want to do this? And Skype is gone. It's not here, it's not running. Okay? So that's it for today, folks. I hope you get something out of this. We'll get the video up online as quickly as we can. Thank you so much.
That's Computer Club Listen for today. Thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.